Good morning and happy Sunday. It's the 23rd of October. Thank you for choosing to wake up with Ireland AM.
Yeah, thank you. Coming up this morning, we'll be looking at the stories making the Sunday newspapers, including the latest on the race to replace Liz Truss as the UK Prime Minister.
And Leinster get one over Munster again, and Manchester United and Chelsea played out a 1-1 draw. We'll chat you through your Sunday sport at 9:30.
And over on the catwalk, we've styles that'll take you from now right through to spring.
From muddy GAA pitches to the hot, hot heat of Kenya, Alan Kerins and Tom Parsons will be joining us to tell us about the 50 GAA stars who are taking part in the first All-Star game to be played in Africa next month.
And she's been coined the First Lady of Irish country music, singing legend Susan McCann will be stopping by after 11.
And we're saying arachno to arachnids this Halloween with some top tips to keep our eight-legged pals out of the house. Are we fearful of spiders?
Can I tell you a quick spider one?
Yeah.
Visited an aunt in Australia one time, said, "Auntie Joan, there's a spider on the kettle." She came in, the spider, I'm not joking, was that size. She picked it up, threw it out the window, and she said, "Ruth, you just need to be scared of the small ones." It was the size of your hand.
Auntie Joan's a tough woman. She's made of tough stuff. Her kettle's made of metal. Probably a plastic one. All right, let's check in on the news you're waking up to today. Sunday with Cliodhna Russell.
Thanks, Ray. Good morning. The three government party leaders meet tomorrow to discuss the lack of available spaces for refugees arriving here. The crisis has been causing huge concerns for those working to help refugees fleeing from Ukraine.
No room left in state accommodation. That's the reality facing people arriving here in need of emergency accommodation this weekend. It's understood Dublin Airport has been looking at providing temporary facilities for those who arrive here with nowhere to go. Ireland has taken in 58,000 people in the past year, mainly but not all fleeing Ukraine, compared with just over 7,000 people this time last year. But in recent days, it's emerged the transit hub at City West Hotel has reached capacity. Tomorrow, the three government party leaders and a number of ministers are set to discuss the accommodation crisis in a pre-cabinet meeting. Any proposals or suggestions on how to deal with it would go before the cabinet on Tuesday. Marie Mulcahy, Virgin Media News.
Speaking in Dublin last night, Taoiseach Micheál Martin was asked about the lack of accommodation for refugees.
We never before ever had to accommodate so many people in such a short space of time as we have done now. And it's because we're in a wartime situation. There is no other explanation for it. We will continue in terms of building additional capacity and doing everything we possibly can in terms of this issue. And this is Europe-wide. You can visit other capital cities, other countries are experiencing similar situations. Some countries have had people in tents for quite a long time because of the sheer numbers fleeing war. So I think that this is not just an Irish phenomenon, it is a European-wide phenomenon, unfortunately. But we certainly will do everything we can to speed things up and get more accommodation into play.
Well, according to the head of the Irish Red Cross, the process to verify privately pledged accommodation to Ukrainian refugees has been slow and more resources and staff are needed to streamline it. There are currently 700 private households under review, while thousands are still waiting to welcome Ukrainians.
There are certainly at least another 3,000 pledges out there that are available for use. And we certainly are placing people every day, as I know our other agencies. I think probably more resources in all of the organisations, but especially the local authorities, would help. It is very difficult for everybody at the moment, particularly for people arriving and finding that they have to stay at the airport or there's nowhere for them to go. But what we have noticed is an increasing number of commercial providers who are coming into the market now to the government saying, look, we can provide commercial accommodation for 20, 40, 50 and more people.
In the UK, the race to be the next Prime Minister is entering its final hours. Boris Johnson and Rishi Sunak were said to be in talks last night, with speculation mounting over whether the pair could agree on a joint ticket. Although neither of them have yet confirmed they are candidates, Penny Mordaunt was first to declare she would be taking part in the race, but has so far not reached the required support threshold. Chinese President Xi Jinping has been reconfirmed as the head of the country's ruling party for a precedent-breaking third term in office. The new five-year term essentially paves the way for him to rule China for life. It comes after a week-long political meeting which eliminated key rivals and strengthened his political power. He also introduced a new seven-man ruling committee stacked with his allies.
For car insurance, van insurance, or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
This morning, we can expect wet and cloudy conditions with possible thunderstorms and some spot flooding. Morning temperatures will range from 12 to 14 degrees. The afternoon will see a gradual clearing off rain clouds, resulting in sunny spells and scattered showers in the south. Temperatures will range between 13 and 15 degrees. And tonight, we can anticipate more showery rain pushing into the western areas with a chance for pockets of mist and fog. Overnight temperatures will range between 9 and 11 degrees.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell of a
quote. Stay with us. We're looking at the big stories making the Sunday papers after this quick break.
Welcome back. Now let's check in on your morning newspapers, and we'll start with the Sunday Independent. Their headline reads, Mary Lou's husband in threat to sue Shane Ross. The paper reports that the husband of Mary Lou McDonald is threatening to sue Shane Ross for defamation following his recent biography of the Sinn Féin leader.
The Business Post then opens with the exclusive Pfizer to invest €1 billion in new Dublin biotech plant. They state that the pharmaceutical giant is in the advanced stages of expensive plans for its Grange Castle site in Dublin, with an expected completion date of 2026.
And the Sunday Times leads with refugees from Ukraine denied roof overhead. They write that the Taoiseach has defended the government's response to the Ukraine crisis after it emerged that more than 30 refugees who arrived in Ireland this weekend had been turned away from state-provided accommodation.
Now onto the tabloids. The Irish Mail on Sunday opens on the headline McEntee U-turn on release of Boxer's killer. They write on Justice Minister Helen McEntee's controversial decision to repatriate the convicted murderer of Irish boxer Kevin Sheehy, allowing him to return to his home country of England.
The Irish Sunday Mirror leads with €5 million to kill Hutch. The paper claims that the Kinahans have put up a €5 million bounty on Jerry the Monk Hutch, with the gangster's close associates also having a new price on their heads.
Sunday World also looking at the Kinahan cartel with their headline reading, Cartel's Flashy Boss. They go on to discuss Ross Browning, who has been described in court as the Kinahan cartel's principal man in Ireland, who made millions dealing drugs to the Gucci gang.
And finally, The Sun on Sunday leads with Browned Off. The paper also discusses the Ross Browning case, stating that Browning was discovered using a fake passport to travel and meet with mob boss Daniel Kinahan. Now, for all those stories and more, joining us to chat through the stories, we've got Shiona Cahill, former USI president and current affairs commentator, and Barry White, chief reporter with Bauer Media Audio. Barry and Shiona, thanks so much
morning.
For joining
morning.
Us.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. I will start with Shiona. We'll start with Shiona, am I pronouncing that right? I knew I was going to get it wrong.
You're doing great.
It's always,
thanks
it's
very much. Yeah, it's a huge relief.
No, an attempt was made. You know?
Shiona.
Yeah.
Shiona,
yeah.
My apologies.
Not at all.
We'll start with the refugee crisis. Yeah. And I suppose with it's beginning to bite now in terms of people coming into this country looking for refugees.
It's been biting for a while, Ray. And I think, you know, when you have the Micheál Martin put under pressure at the Fianna Fáil presidential dinner last night about the fact that I think 33 people were turned away from state accommodation in relation to coming from Ukraine, fleeing war, and then not getting housing here of any kind, I think that really tells you just how much it is biting. But yeah, I mean, look at what we're looking at here is a total lack, it feels like anyway, of a coordinated long-term plan when it comes to housing refugees and people seeking asylum in the state here from Ukraine fleeing war.
It can hardly be surprising, though, considering the housing crisis that we have for people who've been living here for years anyway. And Barry, do you want to jump in on that?
Yeah, well, Micheál Martin said it was not fair to suggest the government were underprepared for this. Mm. But like you mentioned, the housing crisis. The housing crisis was here in Ireland long before the war in Ukraine. We were told in March that we were going to have 100,000 Ukrainian refugees were going to arrive here. So the government knew how many people are going to arrive here. Hotels, B&Bs and guest houses were being used to accommodate refugees and asylum seekers to begin with. I think there's one quarter of all hotels, B&Bs and guest houses have been used across the country. We're now kind of running out of accommodation there. So we knew this was going to happen. The government were underprepared. So for Micheál Martin saying that that's unfair, it's not unfair. It's just stating the obvious.
So what's the numbers? Like over 30 people this weekend? 33 men, is it?
Yeah, 33 men. And then, look, 42,000 Ukrainian refugees are being accommodated here in state accommodation with the government. Then you have another 10,000 people who are looking for international protection, so people looking to gain asylum.
Yeah.
And there's still hundreds of people arriving here every week. So, you know, what's the end game here? Where are these people going to go? The government keep coming out and saying they will not put a cap on refugees or asylum seekers. But the message now, it seems to be, we'll put the message across Europe, we'll have no cap, but if you come here, you might end up in the streets. It's not a good look. It's not a good look. And then what's the long-term plan as well? Because come next summer, you know, some of these hotels and stuff are looking to go back to accommodate tourists. There doesn't seem to be a long-term plan. The war in Ukraine isn't going to end anytime soon either.
And in fact, it's exacerbated even.
Yeah.
The numbers then increasing of more and more places being bombed and people needing to come to Ireland for sanctuary and wherever is available.
Yeah, but it does seem to be that we're running out of accommodation, but yet there doesn't seem to be any plan.
And for me, like, I mean, you're looking at the fact that this is sitting with the Department of Children and Youth Affairs, in effect, and not housing. Like, the first thing that we need to do when these people are coming into the country is to try and accommodate them, give them a place, a room, a bed to sleep on. And obviously, there's so many more things that come after that around the schooling system and education for the young people, childcare, and then the fact that these people are traumatised. They're going to need support from state services, not just now, not for the next 6 months, probably for the rest of their lives to a point. And it just feels like we don't have a plan for that. I mean, the fact that even during the week we're hearing of so many people who had said to the Red Cross, we have a house or we have a room, and they haven't even gotten a call yet or feel like their room is being used or looked at even by the Red Cross. Mm. It's showing that there's a lack of resources here too.
Yeah, so the Red Cross obviously overwhelmed as well.
Yeah.
And I did hear a story about a teacher was saying, you've all these young children arrived in, traumatised, as you say, and no clue about where their education is at. Can they contact their school in Ukraine? Well, no, because it's been
flattened.
Bombed. Yeah.
Yeah, and you're talking about young people who have so little English, trying to navigate life as young teenagers and as kids. And again, that's all about social care and resources. But we're not even getting as far as that conversation because we haven't got the rooms for them to go to. And as you said, it's not a good look.
No, we're just managing rather than coming up with a plan, or at least that's the current criticism. Let's move on to the other big story this weekend, the drama.
The lettuce, really.
The lettuce is still fresh.
It's still going. That lettuce is ready for a salad. Like, you could make a gorgeous salad this weekend. Do you know?
This is it. But with the lettuce and Liz now on the way out, she's currently a placeholder now at the moment.
She is.
Rishi Sunak looks like he's the front runner right now.
Mm-hmm. The lad who couldn't beat her the first time is the guy we're looking at saving the Conservative Party. And also, you know, even the question that we might even be asking this morning and the Sunday papers we're looking at around whether Boris Johnson is still in, you know, in a position. There's kind of rumours that he's gotten the 100 kind of votes he needs to even be on the ballot paper, which the fact I'm sitting on the couch even saying that is just mad to me.
And it's funny because on the couch here on Friday, we had somebody saying, there's no way Boris Johnson's going to get those 100 that he needs. Mm-hmm. Not a chance.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he's back. He's around. And as one person, apparently a government source, said, who in their right mind would think after 6 years of political chaos that the answer is Boris Johnson?
The momentum seemed to be really behind him on Friday. You know, he was returning from the Caribbean. There was more and more Tory MPs coming out on Twitter and saying, we back Boris. Bring back Boris 22 was trending. And I think his price plummeted with the bookies as well. And you were thinking, Jesus, could he really make a comeback here? And
but isn't that like part of it? No more than with Trump, isn't it a compelling story? The story of something dramatic happening again on the political scene. But rather than it being good for anyone.
Yeah, but I think the Boris bubble has burst now.
Right.
Sunak's odds have plummeted. He's got maybe 130 MPs backing him now. So I think maybe by early next week, he's going to be announced as the next Prime Minister. I think a lot of Tory MPs have come out and says, look, we're quitting the Tory party if you bring back Boris. William Hague, the former Tory party leader, come out and says it would be the worst thing that could ever happen to the Tory party in the history of the Conservative Party. So
that's saying a lot.
Well, it has some of his backers. Boris Johnson's like Marmite. A lot of the British public don't like him either, so... We're hearing this,
but then
you know,
if you say he's like Marmite, that means some of them absolutely love him.
Some of them
and are devoted
love
to him.
But, you know, they were saying, oh, Boris is a winner. He gets results. Yeah, he won the election when he went up against Jeremy Corbyn, but a lot has happened since then. And I don't know if he, I don't know if that's a fact that he would be a vote winner. I think
Sheena,
it would be worse for the Tory party if he came back, I think.
Yeah. Mm. Sheena, the excuse me, the Northern Ireland Protocol, has it even come up in discussion while all of this is going on?
No, it's not even coming up in debates with them. As usual, Northern Ireland is just not featuring in the conversation because it's too awkward for them. And obviously they feel like they've got big fish to fry here. I mean, they've got a collapsing economy. And, you know, the Conservative Party is in free fall. So the last thing that they're even, you know, they give a flying about at this point is the DUP drama in Northern Ireland.
Yeah, Ireland being an afterthought, particularly with the Tories, at least at the moment. Barry, that other story, the story of Shane Ross and Mary Lou making the front pages as well. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so Martin Lanigan, Mary Lou McDonald's husband, he claims a chapter on Shane Ross's book on the family home is defamatory and a breach of his financial privacy. So he's looking to take a case against Shane Ross, a defamation case. A letter was hand-delivered to Shane Ross's home in Enniskerry in County Wicklow. Now, Sinn Féin have come out very quickly in this, and they're very much saying that this is Martin Lanigan personally taking a case against Shane Ross, and this is not a party matter. But again, we've heard a lot about Sinn Féin recently about taking cases like this, but as I said, the party are coming out very much and saying, look, this has nothing to do with us. This is a personal case. Martin Lanigan is taking this against Shane Ross. But given who Martin Lanigan is, of course it is going to be linked to Sinn Féin. But, yeah, I don't know if there's much more you can say on it, really.
Right. Well, you've got to be pretty careful if you're going to say
that. Thank you. I will cover the story sufficiently. Some good news then as well in terms of Pfizer, further investment in Ireland. And what is it? A billion euro in a new Dublin biotech plant. Shiona, tell us about that.
We're looking at 4,000 new jobs. But actually, just before we came on air, one of the things we thought we were saying was that, you know, obviously, it's amazing when you hear about a biotech firm, you know, saying we're going to expand our site in Dublin. But where are we going to house potentially all the people who will be moving about? Like, I mean, obviously, there's some incredible degrees around universities and ITs around the country looking at stuff that Pfizer does, producing great graduates. But if they're coming to Dublin to work, where are we going to put them?
And are we going to be able to move them around if they want us all on public transport? How are we, will the infrastructure be there?
Probably on the metro. We're going to stick them on
the metro.
Oh,
yeah.
In,
the
metro, that's perfect.
The metro's not going to be built by 2026.
Is it 2026? They're saying they're going to have it all up and running. And
the Pfizer plant, yeah.
So the metro, I thought you meant the metro.
The jobs will be here by 2026. The metro mightn't be here by 2046.
Yeah, but it is a good news story overall for Ireland.
It is, yeah. I suppose I was saying, if Brexit, if it hadn't happened in Britain, you know, Pfizer could be looking at, you know, moving jobs to the UK, but because of Brexit, that's just not, they're not looking at places like England now. So what's good, and Ireland is becoming a pharmaceutical hub. Many pharmaceutical companies have created thousands of jobs here, and there are thousands of well-paid jobs as well. So it is, on one side, it is really good news.
And favourable tax conditions as well in
they
this
help.
Country for this bigger companies.
Yeah, when it comes to the corporation tax, and then the government, that brings in a lot of money here as well, which can...
We build our future on it.
Yeah, we just can't build a metro.
No,
it's the only problem.
That's it.
Guys, thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Lovely to chat to you.
Right, there's loads of time to get in touch this morning. You can drop us a text for free on WhatsApp. The number is 0896111111.
You can email irlandam@virginmedia.ie.
And you can find us IrelandAM VMTV on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram.
Up next, Off the Balls, Mick McCarthy joins us to digest all of yesterday's sports. So don't go anywhere, we'll see you in three. Welcome back now. If you're lucky enough to have plans for next weekend's bank holiday and you need something to wear, you are in luck.
Stylist Mandy Maher joins us with some options that'll take you right through the winter.
Mandy.
Hello, Mandy.
Good morning.
Isn't she vision in blue?
Vision in blue. Absolutely.
Besides looking earlier on, you're just very kind.
We're
it's
all
amazing, it's amazing what a bit of colour will do and what a bit of makeup will do. We're, all
we're all held together with a bit of a lick and a spit.
Oh, I do love you, thanks.
Now, who do we have first this morning?
So all of our looks this morning are from Carrigdon. Of course, Carrigdon, an Irish success story, 42 stores nationwide. But it's all about getting ready for next weekend. It's all about the bank holiday vibe.
Bank holiday vibe. Now, this jacket is a bank holiday vibe. I think we're gonna start with the dress, are we?
So we can start with the dress. The dress to me is a very retro style dress. Actually, it's a high neck. I'm loving it because it's just, as I said, it's just. Getting all those autumn colours in, and that's exactly what we're doing here this morning with this. Got lots of colours to play with, and that's what I love about something like this, because there's so many options when you add accessories to it, which I just think works really, really well. And we did pop on a pair of heels with this, but if you want to, you could easily go in a knee-high boot with this as well to change it.
I love the shape of this, the little sort of flare out from the waist.
It's girly, isn't it?
Very pretty, yeah.
And you could wrap a belt around that in the centre and really kind of take the waist in, but the waist is already taken in, isn't it?
It is. I probably would an add a belt with this, Paul. I would keep it quite, keep it as is because it doesn't really need it.
Yeah.
But you could, of course, but I just think it's probably better without. Now, the jacket, we were talking about this jacket. I love it.
Structure.
Isn't it gorgeous? It's all this. The girls, we were just talking about this. It's all back to the bolero style jackets, and that's exactly what this is. It's lovely. Amazing how fashion moves around, isn't it? We're going back to what was in fashion a long time ago, and this is what we're going to be seeing a lot of in jackets.
I'll be going up to the attic to pull out those bolero jackets.
Absolutely. What material is that?
It's actually suede. Jacket, and it's really light, but again, like that,
it's very good value,
isn't it? A great value, it's very, very good price point. But again, what's important to remember about fashion is that sit back, see what you have in your wardrobe, what can you mix and match with? And a jacket like this would be great with a plain t-shirt and a pair of jeans as well, so you could easily wear it with lots of other options.
Those earrings are pretty damn fab,
aren't they?
Fab,
and we're coming into the party season, Ruth.
So some of us are always in party season,
well, fair enough, if it is. But I love these. I think they're great. And again, like that, and they're a lovely gift ideas. Well, we've got Christmas coming up. People don't want to talk about it because they're trying to forget about it, but we have to come up with it, we like it or we don't. So I think it's also a great option as well for a gift idea too.
Lovely, lovely.
We've next up.
Igna next.
Oh, we've Igna next,
colours are gorgeous.
Isn't this great? And it's all about pink coming through actually for the season, so we're going to be seeing a lot of pink coming through. But again, it's a wonderful dress. Lots of colours going on in this. I love the fact of the rust with the purples. It really works quite well.
And the same shape on the jacket again.
It is indeed. It's actually the same jacket, only a slightly different shade actually in the jacket. But the dress itself, we can see here, it has a slit detail. It's ideal as well for occasional wear. We dressed it down more so today. It's probably more something you pop on if you're maybe heading for lunch or going meeting the girls or something like that, an outfit like this. But you could easily wear it up and dress it for a wedding if you wanted to, with heels and more of a dressier accessories if you did desire.
And that's what we're looking for. We're looking for those day to night thing completely in our wardrobe to kind of...
Absolutely, absolutely. And then as you see, then we're back to the jacket. The jacket is in a variety of colours actually. And this is a different shade of the green that we'd seen earlier.
It's still a green, is it? Because it has a tinge of grey off of it, but you can see that the more you look at it, you can see the green.
Absolutely,
in it.
You sure can.
I love how you have the confidence with the mixing of the colours, because you have the lovely green handbag then as well.
Doesn't it work great, Ruth? Yeah. And again, like that, they have the bags in lots of options. They have a huge amount of accessories in Carrigdon. But again, you can actually see that slight green is actually in the dress as well. So there's a variety of different green colours in that dress too. And it works well. Do not be afraid to add accessories. I'm a big fan. They always completely change an outfit.
And speaking of those lovely earrings.
Are they gorgeous? Beautiful earring, but of course with that emerald and drop. I'm loving these as well. I think they're fabulous.
Beautiful.
A little bit of green. I see the green sparkling. I'd be hanging on to this for Paddy's Day as well. You don't want to talk about Christmas. I'm jumping ahead to Paddy's Day.
I'm loving it. I'm going to get hammered when we come off here for that one.
Oh, isn't this lovely?
Isn't it great? And this is what I was saying. This is what's going to be on, is on all the catwalks this season for the fashion show season. It's all about the hot pink, and this is really works well in Victoria this morning. I'm loving this. It's a statement dress, definitely very much a statement dress.
And then with the jewellery then, because there's a mix of jewellery we've got there, isn't there?
There is, Paul. We went with the jewellery then. We decided to go with a chain and a matching earrings as well. And again, a wonderful gift set. I'm loving this because, again, it's quite demure, so it's not overpowering. Because sometimes with jewellery, you need to be very careful. It can either make or break an outfit. And that's what's important when you're getting dressed too. Just sit back and see, is there too much, is there too little, you know, and that's literally can make or break an outfit.
And it's interesting then, because you've teamed the hot pink dress with the pink bag and a little bit more sparkle, it's probably kind of brave to go for the all pink, is it? Or is it just something you think that's a real, like, I think that's a real stylish look. I don't think I'd have the nerve to carry it off.
Of course you will have the nerve to carry it off. You will after today.
Shrinking violet like me.
But I love it. And that's what I'm saying. People sometimes think, is it too much? It's not too much. Let people talk about your outfit. If you're walking into a room, why not make a statement? Yeah.
But then as well as that, like we're talking with the day tonight, you can, you know, throw that a pair of runners on that, you can throw a denim jacket over it and you're literally laughing then.
You're sure, Karen, you're fully dressed. And it's that this is just all sample collections of what they have so much coming in stock and carried done. Honestly, it's absolutely wonderful. They're online, as I said, just 42 stores nationwide and some great outfits to show you later on as well.
I was about to say, you'll be back a little bit later
on. Sure will. Thank you. Thank you both.
Thanks, Mandy.
Thanks.
Lovely to have you in this morning. Thank you. Still to come, hold yourself back, spiders and Barmbrack. Sure, it's the season for it, isn't it? See you after this break.
Colin's sonny Larry. Didn't you and he used to be the best of friends?
We're still the best of friends.
No, you're not.
Who says we're not?
Sit somewhere else.
Now, if I've done something to you, just tell me what I've done to you.
When you didn't do anything to me.
I just don't like you no more.
You didn't like me yesterday.
What's going on with you, me feckin' brother?
He's dull, Siobhan.
But he's always been dull.
The other night, 2 hours you spent talking to me about the things you found in your little donkey shite that day.
Well, it wasn't me little donkey shite, it was me pony shite, which shows how much you were listening.
I have a set of shears at home, and each time you bother me from this day on, I'll take those shears and I'll take one of my fingers off with them, and I'll give that finger to you until I have no fingers left. Does this make things clearer to you?
Not really, no.
Starting from now. But shush like, Polly. You know, shush like.
Yeah, I'd shush like.
Would you not want him to have to do the one finger to see if he was bluffing like?
No, we wouldn't.
Because worse comes to worse, he can still play the fiddle with 4 fingers, I bet you.
Going back to your own gang now, Polly.
And talking to me, are you?
Why aren't you talking to Polly no more?
That wouldn't be a sin now, would it, Father?
No, but it's not very nice either, is it?
Do you know who we remember for how nice they was in the 17th century?
Who?
Absolutely no one. Yeah, we all remember the music at the time. Everyone to a man knows Mozart's name.
I don't, so there goes that theory.
Can't be waiting around for any more of this madness.
Let's just call it quits.
We won't call it quits. We'll call it the start.
Thanks, Cliodhna. Now let's check on your morning papers. We'll start with the Sunday Independent. And their headline reads, Mary Lou's husband in threat to sue Shane Ross. The paper reports that the husband of Mary Lou McDonald is threatening to sue Shane Ross for defamation following his recent biography on the Sinn Féin leader.
The Business Post then opens with the exclusive Pfizer to invest €1 billion in new Dublin biotech plant. They state that the pharmaceutical giant is in advanced stages of expensive plans for its Grange Castle site in Dublin with an expected completion date of 2026.
And the Sunday Times leads with refugees from Ukraine denied roof overheads. They write that the Taoiseach has defended the government's response to the Ukraine crisis after it emerged that more than 30 refugees who arrived in Ireland this weekend had been turned away from state-provided accommodation.
On to the tabloids, and the Irish Mail on Sunday opens on the headline, McEntee U-turn on release of Boxer's killer. They write on Justice Minister Helen McEntee's controversial decision to repatriate the convicted murderer of Irish boxer Kevin Sheehy, allowing him to return to his home country of England.
The Irish Sunday Mirror leads with €5 million to kill Hutch. The paper claims that the Kinahans have put a €5 million bounty on Jerry the Monk Hutch, with the gangster's close associates also having a new price on their heads.
Sunday World are also looking at the Kinahan cartel with their headline reading, Cartel's Flashy Boss. They go on to discuss Ross Browning, who's been described in court as the Kinahan cartel's principal man in Ireland, who made millions dealing drugs to the Gucci gang.
And finally, The Sun on Sunday leads with Browned Off. The paper also discusses the Browning case, stating that he was discovered using a fake passport to travel and meet with mob boss Daniel Kinahan.
Now, I have a question for both of you.
Oh, God.
Shoot.
Too early.
Are you Swifties?
Yeah. Oh, did, Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
Tay Tay. Yes.
Would you be a Tay Tay Swiftie?
I'm,
would you
I'm
be a
Ray
Swiftie
Ray.
Fan?
I'm a mild fan of Tay Tay.
Ray Ray like a Tay Tay.
Ray Ray.
Yeah, she's had a few bangers. Yeah, up and down. Yeah. A
few bangers. Well, the new album Midnights is out, having dropped this Friday, and of course, good old County Wicklow gets a shout in. Yeah, in Sweet Nothing, she sings. I spy with my little tired eye, tiny as a firefly, a pebble that we picked up last July. Deep down inside your pocket, we almost forgot it. Does it ever miss Wicklow sometimes?
Oh, was she over with the boyfriend?
She was over with the boyfriend. I wonder, did she stay in Paris Court now? I wonder where she was staying. Did she pick up that pebble on a beach somewhere?
A few nice B&Bs around there.
Yeah, so it was believed that she was here with her boyfriend, Joe Alwyn, last July. And, of course, the last time we chatted about Taylor Swift on this show, we talked about the fact that an American university were doing Taylor Swift studies.
That's right.
Oh, so yeah, they were using her lyrics to study with the school. And do you think you could tell the difference now between Tay Tay and a bit of William Shakespeare?
Unlikely. She's the great poet of our time.
She is. I'm with Ray on this one. Go on.
Well,
try
listen,
us.
We're going to try a few, right?
All right, go on.
And you have to tell us whether it's Tay Tay or William Shakespeare, right? So the first one. So scarlet it was, the mark they saw.
That's very Shakespeare.
Yeah, Shakespeare.
Shakespeare, is it?
You're wrong, it's Tay Tay.
No! Yes. Right, go on.
Number two, Spider Boy, King of Thieves, weave your webs of opacity.
I'm going to say that's Tay Tay.
I'm going to say Shakespeare because you're messing with us now.
I've given you a bit of an accent just so you can kind of, you know, really feel
that's
it.
Shakespeare, is it?
No, it's Swiftie.
Oh, no!
Yes!
Number three, oh, this is going to be a hard one. You kiss by the book.
That's it. You kiss
That's
by
all
the
you're getting. That's all you're getting.
See, all those English classes, all that Leaving Cert English wasted.
God.
I'm going to go with Shakespeare. I haven't got a clue.
Romeo and Juliet, Shakespeare. Oh. Yes. Another one. Before you painted all my nights, a colour I've searched for since.
Ooh.
Shakespeare.
Tay-Tay.
I'm just guessing.
I'm just saying the opposite of what he says.
Swiftie.
Yes.
That's Taylor. Right.
And we'll get one more.
Go on.
Sit by my side and let the world slip.
Oh, that's Shakespeare.
I'll say Shakespeare. I'll just say what she said.
Yes, it's the Taming of the Shrew.
All right, I knew it.
Yes.
Yeah, he's right.
Yes,
knew it, yeah.
Yes.
Junior cert. Yeah.
Excellent. Putting on the glasses now after all that Shakespeare. So this is my favourite time of the year because this is the time when the Comedy Wildlife Photography Awards are happening.
Okay.
And every year, photographers submit their photos. And this isn't kind of like the Attenborough-style classy photos. These are the comedy ones. So it's been running since 2015, and the 40 finalists for 2022 have just been announced. So the first one, these are just a couple of the finalists. Waving Bear is the very first photo.
How are you doing? It's morning.
Isn't it lovely? Hiya. Hiya. That is from a chap called Dave Schaefer.
Where are they now? It's all over the world, is it?
All over the world, I'm guessing, yeah. This one is called, not surprisingly, Bear and Fish. Can you imagine having to hang around in the cold to try and get that picture at that exact moment?
But imagine when you do. Imagine be a nice when bit, you get that picture.
You'd be like, give me a bit of that fish now, lad. I'm starving. I've been hanging around here for so long. Sassy Penguins is a picture by Jennifer Hadley.
Oh, my goodness. Look at that.
Oh, God, I love it. Oh, no, she didn't.
That's me on a night out now talking to somebody.
Anybody. Get out of my face.
Get out of my face.
So are these just luck, then? You're taking the photographs and there's a random photograph. More than going through your photographs of your dog and you're like, oh, he looks like he's laughing there.
Yeah, probably,
so it's just like,
yeah.
You just get lucky.
Except
and throw it
this
in.
Isn't people like just taking a picture of their dog at home. This is people sitting out in
wildlife photographs,
for hours.
Yeah.
Maybe
if you were a very, very serious wildlife photographer and that was the one that made you famous, yeah, you'd be like, oh, God.
Well, sassy penguins.
You will love the next one.
All right, go on.
This one's called Farting Zebra.
That's a
strange
looking
farting zebra. That's called Loving Seals.
That's Loving Seals. That's the strangest looking zebra I've ever seen.
Look like all their bones. There's the farting. Farting Zebra, as taken by Vince Burton. I could see that being on over fireplaces all around Ireland very soon. Alan Panzier took the next one, which is called Attack Squirrel.
Oh, my goodness. Oh.
Like a ninja squirrel, that's class.
Yeah, I feel like there could be an animated film made out. It probably already is, actually. It's not like the thing in Ice Age. Then
scratch.
After Attack Squirrel, we have Monkey Pals by Federico Vinci.
Oh, that's cute.
Oh, that's something cute about monkeys. And then you hear the stories of Don't Look Them in the Eye.
Don't
if you're ever.
Yeah,
don't look a monkey in the eye. Arthur Tell has the last one.
They say the same thing about Alan Hughes.
Drunk Fish.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is like the end of the night selfie, isn't it?
That's what my phone sees every morning when I get up and wake. And like the first time I look at my phone.
Before we have our cup of coffee.
So they are our wildlife finalists. I'm particularly fond of, I think, Farting Zebra.
Yeah, I think that's the winner. Yeah.
Sassy Penguin for me. Sassy penguin. That'll be me now to Ruth for the rest of the show.
I've got chainsaws for you. Oh. Chainsaw culture. Do you know it was a thing, chainsaw?
No.
I was reading about this morning. The Sunday Times has found that middle-aged Irish men, check, were getting seriously into chopping wood and spending a fortune on the wood chopping gear. So chopping wood and chainsaws.
Do you know, actually, my husband is obsessed with buying a chainsaw and I just keep saying, no, I'd like you to retain both your legs.
Right,
so
okay.
Are you retaining your legs
or your head?
I didn't realise it was a trend for middle... Is this something you've been thinking about buying?
No, not at all. But I can, do you know what? I can kind of see the appeal of it. The paper says it's the era of men in chainsaw trousers. One supply... the statistics are unreal. In the last 3 months alone...
Yeah.
Over the last 90 days, they've seen a 25% increase in chainsaw sales compared to the same time last year. So we're buying way more chainsaws.
You know what that is? People are chopping down trees because they're worried about the cost of electricity. They're going to be burning trees.
Burning wood instead of spending money on coal. That's a fair point. And there's also been a 55% increase in website traffic for men looking at helmets. And so safety first, boys.
A helmet's going to work when you swing a chainsaw down in front of your knees.
Put your legs off.
There's been a 300% rise in website searches for axes, because that's the other thing. They're saying that it's... you can vent your frustration with an axe or a hatchet chopping up wood.
Really?
And getting your frustrations out on the wood.
I'm concerned.
Just have a gin and tonic. Like,
yeah,
the rest
do you know,
of
have
it.
You seen those places where you go and you throw a hatchet to try and hit a target?
They're supposed to be amazing. Have you done it?
No.
Have you tried it?
No.
A couple of pals of mine have done it. I think is there a place in Wicklow? Drop us in on the texty. There's a couple of places you can do it.
We'll throw hatchets around the place.
The hatchet throwing. It's supposed to be great crack.
Well, like you say, it'll take all the aggro out of your day.
The frustrations. Between farting zebras and getting Shakespeare and Tay-Tay wrong, the next thing I need to do is chuck a hatchet somewhere.
If you're chucking hatchets, there's lots of time to get in touch and let us know. You can text us for free on WhatsApp. The number is 0896111111.
You can email irelandam@virginmedia.ie.
And you can find us at Ireland AM VMTV on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram.
After the break, we're going on a hunt for the ring in our very own Barmbrack. That's in the kitchen next. Welcome back. It's nearly Halloween, which means it's time for chocolate, lollipops, crisps. And if that wasn't enough, how about a loaf of bread with raisins and a ring in it?
Perfect. It's time for a bit of Barmbrack. And Patrick Ryan from Firehouse Bakery in Delgany joins us this morning. No better man talk us through the brack. This is a tradition, the Halloween tradition, Patrick.
It is. So Halloween originates in Ireland. It comes from the festival Sauna. So this... Barmbrack traditionally came with like a fortune-telling game. So you'd have like different things could be found inside, like, as you say, a ring, a stick, uh-huh. a cloth. It's kind of where the original kind of festival came from, and that's why we thought it'd be next week, appropriate, easy to make. So basically what we're doing is we're making a very simple, enriched, yeasted loaf. You're going to be using a little bit of fresh yeast. I've got a dough on here already, which is just 500 grams of strong flour, 5 grams of salt, 50 grams of sugar, 300 mils of milk, and an egg. And we've added to that some orange zest and some ground cinnamon.
Okay.
Just to add some spice and some flavour. So you can do this by hand. If you have a mixer with a dough hook, feel free to use it. The dough hook does exactly what your hands should be doing. So I just have this already started because it's going to be mixing for about 8 to 10 minutes.
Yeah.
You'll always find enriched doughs take a little bit longer to come together than, say, a traditional basic bread recipe.
Okay.
If you're using a mixer, just be patient, let it go on slow, gentle speed, because we don't want to generate too much heat within our dough. But you'll find as your dough comes together, we finish it then by dropping in about 50 grams of butter. And this just helps it really enrich it.
Soft butter.
Just yeah.
Room temperature. If you're doing it by hand then, what is the risk of a heating up then off your hands?
So with your hands, not so much, isn't going to be a problem. Basically, we have a thing called a friction temperature. It's created by the mixer.
In the machine.
But with your hands, like the mixer, generates more constant. You'll get tired first. Mixer won't.
Yeah. You're guaranteed. 10 minutes of it.
We're using some fresh yeast. So just looks a bit like Play-Doh. If you don't have fresh yeast, dry yeast works perfectly fine. The main difference is dry yeast more concentrated, so use less of it. In the recipe, we're using 10 grams of fresh. Use 5 grams of dried.
Gotcha.
So we're going to fill this loaf then with some dried fruits. Currants, raisins, sultanas, cranberries. But we've soaked them in some Earl Grey tea and some whiskey. So ideally you do this overnight. Just make them really juicy, really plump, as opposed to
just
kind of add them straight
in. You've drained them, have you?
No, so basically I've had 300 grams of dried fruits and I've had 100 grams of tea. So it'll soak it all up. And even, even if there is a little bit left, that's fine.
That's okay, it's not going to seep into the dough.
The dough will absorb it.
Okay.
So you'll find as you add the fruit, then your dough's going to go a bit like squidgy, messy,
yeah,
because it just takes a little bit for it to work in. And the reason we kind of add the fruit at the very end, because if we put this in at the very beginning, the mixer would just break it up, pulverize it, kind of turn it into a puree, but we want to keep the fruit intact.
You want to keep a shape to the fruit.
So once our dough is fully developed, we just add our fruit in and mix it just enough to blend it. That's it.
Can you do this with the kids if you're, you know, on the Halloween break and kind of getting ready for the...
Oh, absolutely. Get their hands in. There's no real wrong way of kneading.
Yeah.
But they have to get in. And great, it's a great thing about baking with kids. Once they're involved in it, they're definitely going to eat it.
Yeah, it's
a great thing to do. So I'm just going to leave that mixing nice and slowly. Great thing about this, though, is you can do all the hard work the day before. Simply knead it, mix it, put it into a bowl, throw it in the fridge. Leave it there all night.
Leave it there.
So you're going to let it rise now, are you?
Yeah, because a lot of people get put off by bread making or baking because the perceived amount of time, 4 or 5 hours, I'm not making something like that. Literally, I threw this together, 10 minutes mixing, shoot in the fridge, and that is simply it.
Oh, give us a look at that. Oh, right, OK. So this is after... How long has that been sitting there?
So that's been overnight in the fridge. So even at cold temperatures, your dough will improve, but just nice and slowly.
Yeah.
So can I ask you a question?
You can.
When do I put the coin in and the ring and all that?
I was going to ask that.
So if you wanted to actually like do this at home...
Well, if you're doing it with the kids, you're going to do
absolutely,
all the bits
and parts, aren't you? When we get to this stage... So basically what we need to do is we're going to just knock our dough back.
Right, so it's not at the point with the mixer then, or when you're kneading it, it's at this point, yeah?
So we can just put it back.
Right.
So basically as the yeast gets to work, it breaks down the sugars in your dough, it produces carbon dioxide, and that's what causes your dough to rise.
Uh-huh.
So by knocking it back... So we just need to divide it. So depending on what you're going to bake it in, I'm just using these small cake rounds, little pie dishes. I'm going to divide it into three. If we're using a bigger one, just increase the weight.
Lovely.
We're about 420 grams is kind of what I'm looking for based on the quantity of dough that I have. So now if you were shaping out at this point and you wanted to pop it in, you could just spread it out, pop your little, you could pop the ring in.
Pop the ring in.
Yeah, or whatever you wanted to put into it. As I say, if you want to put an iPad into it, very
well. A modern interpretation of it will be maybe an iPhone or a USB cable.
Yeah.
Something people will use. Do you know what the different things are?
What?
I looked at the different items you can get here in Barmbrack. A ring means what?
Oh, God.
You get married.
Yeah,
get married.
Thank God. I was like, what have I missed there?
If you get a stick, it means that you're going to have an unhappy marriage.
Oh.
If you get a coin, it means you're going to be rich. A piece of cloth means you're going to have bad luck or you're going to be poor. And there was another one. Oh, there was a pea. There was a pea. It means you're not going to get married.
So
like a vegetable pea. So you don't put any other kind of pea in your Barmbrack.
If you gift that to people, though, are you like, here's a stick, you're not going to get married?
No. It comes up randomly. You have your slice. Isn't that the way it works?
Yeah, and whoever slices it gets it. So basically, once your dough is divided, we just want to mould them into little rounds. So obviously, this could go into a loaf tin. It doesn't have to go into a round. It depends. Whatever you have works perfectly fine. So just roll it straight round. Again, when you're shaping bread, try not to use too much flour because it actually hinders you. So just a little bit on your hands if you need it.
Why does it hinder you?
Because basically what we do, as we roll the dough, we want the dough to grip the table. It pulls in underneath and makes it tighter. It's what gives us the structure.
Okay.
If you lose loads of flour, it just slides around. It's very difficult to work with.
Just a small little bitting. It's a lovely light colour. I would have associated Brack with being quite a little bit darker.
The fruits will tend to colour it. Then as the fruits work in, the little bit of cinnamon will darken it slightly. But then once it comes together, and once it's been shaped, it'll take about probably 2 hours, 2 to 2.5 hours at room temperature to prove, which will give us something.
And you leave it again, okay,
right. It'll grow again.
And you've got a glaze then to do.
Yeah, so basically, once it's ready at this point, when your dough's ready, you should have a little bounce.
Yeah.
There should be no fear of touching it and it collapsing. If it kind of feels like it's going to drop, you've overproved it. So then we're going to bake this. Most bread recipes, we bake at a slightly higher temperature, like 230, 240. But with this, because of the sugar content, about 200 degrees is perfect.
Okay.
I'm going to bake it for 25 minutes.
Yeah.
25 to 30 minutes. So while your loaf is baking, we want to make a little whiskey glaze.
Oh, lovely.
So we just got a little drop of water, and then we're just going to add some whiskey. And some sugar.
Any specific type of sugar?
Just cast sugar is fine, because I don't really want to darken my... It's just a little kind of a sugar glaze, but just with that kick of whiskey. So we let that heat up. And then...
Oh, look at that.
After about 25 minutes, because you'll find once it hits the heat, it'll jump.
That looks lovely.
And this will give us our little...
Oh, so you're not putting the glaze on before it's when it's all done and dusted? Yeah,
yeah, so this is what... we're basically going to let it soak in then as it cools. It gives this a beautiful shine to it. And you get that like a sweet coatness to it. And just add a kick of whiskey then as
and
well.
And when you put the glaze on, do you have to let it sit for a while or can it be eaten straight away?
Well, the only thing about this now, it'll just be... You can try, like, oh, it'll just be very, very hot. It might feel a little bit doughy because it's so hot. Obviously, straight from the oven is absolutely amazing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You will let it need to let it cool a little. But just then, you can give it a couple of little brushes, let it soak in, come back, brush it again. It'll give this beautiful shine and add a little sweet coatness to the outside of it.
Perfect.
So then when it's done and it's cool enough to slice, we're going to be left with this little guy. And you can see kind of all the fruit spread throughout it.
Yeah, it's evenly spread.
So the ratio of brack to butter then is 1-to-1, is it?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Minimum.
As much butter as brack. Oh, my word. Would you look at that? That
you butter me a bit there now.
Well, okay, right.
If you don't, want.
You don't mind. As long as you like butter. Stuff. That's.
Yeah, of course. Get a quick taste in.
Generally, what I go nuts on the old
I go nuts on the butter too. I'd be a bit of a butter fiend now.
There you go.
Oh, yeah, and toast it
grab
up.
That. I don't want to paw it with my fingers.
But even like after a couple of days, if it's gone a little bit, it makes the most amazing kind of French toast.
Oh, this is what the discussion we were having earlier on is toasted is almost better, some people were saying. So slice it up and toast it. It's absolutely gorgeous a couple of days later.
That's beautiful. As always, you can find the full recipe on our website or you can catch Patrick at Firehouse Bakery in Delgany or Wicklow Town to try the brack yourself.
And you can make it as well.
Yeah.
Whatever suits you. Up next, GAA legends Alan Kerins and Tom Parsons join us to chat about their up and coming humanitarian trip to Kenya. We'll see you on that in just a moment.
Welcome back. Now, next month we'll see Galway football and hurling legend Alan Kerins lead over 50 male and female players from the GAA to Kenya for a very special humanitarian project, which will see the first ever inter-county game played in Kenya.
And we're joined by the man himself, Alan, as well as former Mayo player and CEO of the Gaelic Players Association, Tom Parsons, who'll also be heading off alongside Alan in aid of Self-Help Africa. Gentlemen, thanks so much for joining us.
Good morning.
And thanks for not eating all of the brack. I know they're...
No, they've only got ice for the brack.
Have some later, yeah. Oh, we will, don't worry.
Oh, you will. Afterwards. We'll get through this first, OK? Hold your waist. Alan, we start with you. Tell us a little bit about the project and how did it get started?
Yeah, I suppose, I've been working in Africa over 15, since 2005, 17 years. And I suppose it's a huge passion of mine. And then the GA is a huge passion. And I always had a dream or a vision of bringing an inter-county match or an all-star trip or some kind of trip to Africa. And it's coming about now in November where we're bringing over 50 male and female players. So it's quite a historic trip, as in it's the first ever, you know, trip of this significance with representatives from all the four codes, Camogie, ladies football, hurlers and footballers, as first inter-county game in Kenya. And I suppose the big theme is history and legacy. The players are all raising €10,000 each with the hope of planting 1 million trees and leaving a massive collective legacy behind as a group.
So tell me about them. The planting trees in Kenya is going to help the communities in Kenya. Explain to me a little bit about that.
Yeah, well, it's probably over 8 or 9 different countries in Africa over the next few months. But the idea is not only will it have a huge environmental impact with the sequestering of carbon, but also all the trees will be planted in communities that Self-Help Africa work with. And they'll be trained and educated and provided with technical support to live off these trees. So these trees will be linked to their livelihoods.
I was going to say, how do you make a living out of a tree?
Yeah, your food crops. So a lot of these will be mangoes, cashew nuts, academias, citrus juice, passion fruits. It has multiple benefits, really, not just food crops, cash crops. There'll also be plant trees to help to rehabilitate degraded soil, improve the nutrients and nitrogen in the soil, shelter. Shelter belts, soil erosion. So there's multiple benefits to these communities who have contributed least to the climate change but are affected most by climate change, as we can see in the news recently with the famines in Somalia and East Africa.
And has the environmental side of things something you've always been interested in?
Yeah, well, I suppose we have to now, don't we?
Well, we do, but not everybody kind of gets on board with it. So what you're doing is quite exceptional.
Yeah, and we hope that the players and their profiles and their hugely positive role models in society, that they will bring that level of awareness and that level of, and inspire younger generations to get involved in this. We believe it's the biggest fight of our time, and we believe we're kind of inviting players to become part of the most important team.
Yeah, absolutely. Tom, have you bought the sun cream?
He doesn't need it.
I need to know, but I definitely need to catch a few rays to catch up with this man.
Absolutely, Jaker, it has to be said. What is the weather like in Kenya? Like, it's next month, isn't it?
Yeah, next month. It'll be nice, yeah. It'll be nice, yeah.
It won't be like playing in 40
no,
degrees.
No, no, it'd be magic playing under, you know, under that sun and the stars and the sand. And
What kind of a reaction do you expect to get then? What kind of awareness is there for GAA over there?
There's huge awareness at the moment. We're working with brighter communities worldwide and set up Africa team on the ground in Kenya.
Yeah.
And they're looking after brilliantly all our logistics. But there's a huge excitement amongst the Irish missionaries, the Irish diaspora, the business community there. And we're also working with Brother Colin O'Connell, who trains all the Kenyan athletes. He's trained something like 25 World Olympic champions. So some of his athletes are coming to play in the game. So there's huge excitement and media building around the game. And we hope to have a fairly decent crowd with Kenyan schools and all that coming.
I was wondering, all right, if you were going to get some of the Kenyans to get involved in playing the game.
We are.
I hope that's going to be filmed, because I think that'll be great.
Yeah, we are working. There's a documentary being made on it that'll be aired at Christmas. So,
fabulous.
It's great to capture that.
Yeah. Tom, aside from the sun cream, what other preparations are you doing ahead of this? Or are you getting ready for?
Well, I suppose what's so inspiring about it is there was no player that had to be asked twice.
Really?
You know, every player that was asked, you know, straight away got stuck in and raised the money, from table quizzes to reaching out to their companies. And you know, they really captured the hearts and minds of people in their communities. And that's why the GPA really wanted to get on board with this. And, you know, what's really interesting as well is the mix of male and female players. And, you know, equality in Gaelic games is really topical at the moment. So we're going to have that mixed game in Kenya. That'll be special. And, you know, that role modelling piece is about boys and girls seeing, you know, their stars, you know, in Kenya, you know, planting a million trees, the sustainability piece, the equality piece. So it hits so many facets that we need to hit today.
Has there ever been a male-female game, you know, even in Irish history, a sort of an anniversary or a special one-off or anything like that, even?
Not that I'm aware of. Okay. So, you know, that'll be really special.
This is pretty special, yeah.
So who's going? You don't need to name them all.
I go one. all 50 names.
Alan has the list, so let Alan.
We have a great mix from all counties.
Right.
So with the likes of, we've representatives from the four All-Ireland winning teams, so Sean Finn and Tom Morris, who are going from the Limerick team. You have Neva Sullivan from Meath, Grace Walsh is Kilkenny, and you have Stephen O'Cumber from Kerry. But you're the likes of, you know, Neil McManus in Antrim and Jane Adams in Antrim, Podge Collins in Clare. You have Dara Egan, and you have Matt O'Hanlon and Jack O'Connor and Liam O'Gorman from Wexford, Mickey Quinn from Longford. So you have
anyone from Roscommon?
There's three, actually.
Woo-hoo!
There's Alton Harney is going. You have Roisin Wynn, and you have Neil Collins, a famous artist as well.
Are they all travelling together? What about old rivalries on the plane? On the way over, will there be simmering feuds being brought back?
This is what we're trying to break down as well, because when you're playing at an inter-county level, you know, it's hard to actually get players to really express their opinions and be themselves and bring their whole selves to the game. And that's really important, because actually, even with the GPA, we did a big piece on with the LGBTQ+ community, for example.
Uh-huh.
So there's no male player that's come out and has identified as being LGBTQ+. But this gives an opportunity to sell the human interest stories. Mm. Players will be off guard, you know, learn a little bit about players. And we are doing a documentary on it as well, so we're going to get all that footage. And then, you know, that it's the ripple effect of this. This is an amazing initiative, but I think the ripple effect of this will be really significant, you know?
Mm. Tom, you've mentioned mentoring and the importance of, well, not mentoring specifically, but role models. And I suppose you're the CEO of the GPA, and you've been essential in making this happen. There's been a bit of controversy of late. This is something that you guys are having to deal with. How is that sort of spreading itself out for you?
The controversy on?
Well, in terms of aggression at pitches, match side.
Yeah, well, it's so important. I mean, when you get into a dress room at a high performance level, at an inter-county level, you focus so much on culture, values, behaviours. And the fundamental of that is respect and inclusiveness, and they're two core values of the GAA. So it's really unfortunate that we're seeing some instances, and it's unusual, and maybe it's a sign of the, you know, the times that we're in and the unrest in society, because there's 500,000 GAA members, and maybe that's just unfolding on sidelines and on pitches. But it's going to take everybody from the GPA, the GAA, players, coaches, parents, to really, really think about respect. You know, on and off the, on and off the pitch. So it's not going to be any one big initiative, Ruth. It's the hundreds and thousands of little things that we do every day.
Great. Good to hear. Guys, thank you so much for coming in. Great to hear it all. Best of luck with it.
Thank you very much. Looking forward. Try and have a good time as well.
Well, Alan's going to sing a few songs.
We have a few musicians coming, so we're going to have music every night with the Kenyan and Irish music blending it together.
Wow.
So, yeah. Fantastic.
Brilliant.
So we're kind of using sport and music. Well, we are using sport and music as the universal languages to connect people on a human level from different cultures. So.
Great.
Alan, Tom, thanks a million.
Thank you very much.
Enjoy yourselves. And you can follow all the good work done by Warriors for Humanity and their trip to Kenya at warriorsforhumanity.org online.
Now, up next, we're back at the catwalk with more cosy styles for the next bank holiday weekend. Stay with us. We'll see you in three.
Thanks for staying with us. We're looking at styles that'll take you right through to spring.
And stylist Mandy Maher is back with us with three more looks. You're getting us ready for the bank holiday weekend.
I sure am, Ruth.
And you're going to have us going all the way through the spring.
Or it's going to be all head to toe style. We have it all going on. Everything this morning is coming from Carrigdon. As I said, they're a very big Irish company, 42 stores nationwide, and of course also available online as well.
Where are we going first, Mandy?
Well, we had a look at lots of dresses earlier on, so now we're going a little bit more casual. So now it's all about getting cosied up for the travelling for the weekend. So I'm loving this. Really cool, casual, chic, and that's what it's all about this morning.
So the hat is obviously a staple piece with your winter wardrobe.
It sure is. And do you know what I love about a hat like this? Is it a bit of fun?
Yeah.
And do you know why there's a bobble? French sailors, they made it so that when they'd be on a boat and they'd lift their head up and the bobble would hit the boat before their head would.
Well, listen.
I'm learning something new every day. That's one I did not know.
Listen, this jacket is a gorgeous piece. Is it a monochrome mixed with the pink, is it?
It sure is, Paul. And it's actually an updated version of the actual biker jacket. That's what it actually is. So it's kind of like giving a little bit more of a take on a biker jacket.
Kind of Top Gun style.
Yeah, huh? Isn't it gorgeous? And it has, as you can see, it obviously has that faux fur detail on the neckline and running down the lapel of the jacket. It has that check going on. As we know, check is going to be really, really big this season as well. Lots of zips and lots of funkiness, as I do call it, going on with a jacket like this.
And then the top and the watch. We'll go with the top first. So where the top underneath is from?
The top underneath is just a plain black, simple top. I like a top like this because really, there's so much you can do with this because you could easily wear it with a skirt, wear it with lots of other pieces, accessorize it to the last is what I would do with a plain top like this. But we kept it simple because of what was going on with the jacket this morning. You didn't need much more.
And your timepiece on the wrist is always so important.
It sure is. And Carrigdon are well known for their amazing accessories. Lots going on there.
Nice jeans. You cannot beat a good pair of black jeans.
Oh, Ruth, absolutely. I must have about four pairs of black jeans in my wardrobe because, honest to God, they never go wrong. These are great stretch in these jeans. But also what I like, and we understand this, I like a high waist.
Oh, yeah.
They're comfortable, and that's what that whole look is about. It's about comfort, it's about travel, but yes, being able to mix and match, as you said earlier as well. Lots going on with black.
Oh, this is nice too. Let's start with the earrings and see what kind of sparkle we have going on there.
Lots of sparkle going on here again with these great earrings. As we said, it's coming into the festive season. We're getting ready for the party season. But you could wear these also, as you can see, with an outfit like this, which is nice and casual.
Yeah, and the scarf, actually, just as we're starting to head into the chillier days, this is a beaut.
Isn't it gorgeous? And this is all about the blanket scarf. And it's great. Now, we decided, what way would we style this? Of course, I was thinking about a multitude of what way we would do it. We decided to wrap it around the neck. But you could easily wear this down one side of you. You could wear it just hanging down straight, whatever way you want. So there's lots of ways of being able to play around with a scarf like that.
It goes really nicely with that coat as well.
I'm loving the green on this. I don't know, I'm hoping it's coming up as bright as what it actually is here in front, because it's actually a fantastic shade of green. It's padded, it's warm. Paul, you mentioned earlier on about belt.
Giving it the shape, you know, this
it sort of sure way. Is, and that's what I like about this. It's brilliant. Now, obviously, you can take the belt off if you didn't want it, and the belt either. You know, it's obviously optional, but I like the belt with it.
And let's have a look at the bag there as well.
And the bag is all about multi-tones going on in the bag.
Multi-tone.
multi-tone bag, and they have these in a variety of colours, which we'll see another one in a couple of minutes coming out. But I'm loving this again, like that. The whole look just works well. We paired it off with a simple knit underneath, and it just, it's casual, but yet it's chic at the same time.
Yeah. Those jeans, the same as the black one, just in a
exactly different shade. Exactly, that's the blue indigo shade. That's
there's
the
almost like a thick coating look to those jeans, which makes it look so much sturdier, and you know you'll feel better about it because you're wrapped in them, I suppose.
There's a great stretch, but they're also soft, and you brought up a great point on that. Sometimes jeans can be very hard, actually.
Yeah, so it's nice
to get a good, comfortable pair of jeans, and that's exactly what these are.
And they keep their shape as well.
They sure do, which is important, of course.
Now, here's Victoria.
So we decided to end in a little bit of glamour and rock it up a little bit more this time to come back with the dresses style, but I'm loving this. I love the colours in this.
Yeah. Let's start with the earrings, because I literally can see them winking at me here.
And they're gorgeous. I think you're an earring woman. You're loving it. But aren't they gorgeous? I'm loving the colours of this. It's all about the navies. As you can see, the clear drop in that as well. It's just classy. It's beautiful. As I said, I'm a big fan of accessories. I think they always completely finish off any look.
And here, actually, go on.
I'm just going to jump onto that dress. I like a dress with a little bit of a V-neck.
It's lovely, and actually it's quite flattering. And as well as that, then for not so faint hearted, if they didn't want something overpowering on the V-neck, it's actually quite, it's not overpowering on the V, it's quite low.
Suitable for everywhere, really, isn't it?
Exactly. And you see a lovely drop, a lovely flow on this dress. Again, it has all those autumnal colours going on with the browns and the creams, but the navy being the predominant, which we themed with this jacket, as you can see.
I was just about to say, what fabric is it?
It's actually a PU jacket. It's faux leather.
Vegan leather.
Yes, vegan leather. And they have this in a variety of colours. But again, like that, a jacket like this, you'll pull this out in 10 years' time. These won't date.
Yeah.
That's what's fantastic about pieces like these. These are key pieces that you'll forever have.
And the colour's great as well. It's a different, the usual black leather we kind of see.
Yes.
A little bit of navy blue will go with a lot of different stuff over the seasons.
Absolutely, and it always works well. I love navy. Navy's a great colour. But all our looks this morning from Carrick Dunn, as I said, 42 stores nationwide or indeed online.
I think I'm actually looking forward to the bank holiday weekend now.
All set, all ready. The whole shebang. Full wardrobe sorted.
Mandy, thank you so much.
Thank you both. Thank you.
Thank you. So still to come, Queen of Country Susan McCann is going to be stopping by.
Plus Doctor Who, Star Trek and lots of spooky monsters in our preview for next week's especially nerdy TV head highlights. See you in a bit.
Now let's check in on your morning papers, and we'll start with the Sunday Independent. Their headline reads, Mary Lou's husband in threat to sue Shane Ross. The paper reports that the husband of Mary Lou McDonald is threatening to sue Shane Ross for defamation following his recent biography on the Sinn Féin leader.
The Business Post then opens with the exclusive Pfizer to invest €1 billion in new Dublin biotech plant. They state that the pharmaceutical giant is in the advanced stages of expensive plans for its Grange Castle site in Dublin with an expected completion date of 2026.
And the Sunday Times leads with refugees from Ukraine denied roof overheads. They write that the Taoiseach has defended the government's response to the Ukraine crisis after it emerged that more than 30 refugees who arrived in Ireland this weekend had been turned away from state-provided accommodation.
Onto the tabloids now. The Irish Mail on Sunday opens on the headline, McEntee U-turn on release of Boxer's killer. They write on Justice Minister Helen McEntee's controversial decision to repatriate the convicted murderer of Irish boxer Kevin Sheehy, allowing him to return to his home country of England.
The Irish Sunday Mirror leads with €5 million to kill Hutch. The paper claims that the Kinahans have put a €5 million bounty on Jerry the Monk Hutch, with the gangster's close associates also having a new price on their heads.
And the Sunday World also looking at the Kinahan cartel with their headline reading, Cartel's flashy boss. They go on to discuss Ross Browning, who has been described in court as the Kinahan cartel's principal man in Ireland, who made millions dealing drugs to the Gucci gang.
And finally, the Sun on Sunday leads with Browned Off. The paper also discussing the Ross Browning case, stating that he was discovered using a fake passport to travel and meet with mob boss Daniel Kinahan.
I'm still shook.
Bye.
He came in.
Oh, my God. I came in because we're discussing spiders in the show later on. And I went, hey, Ruth, I've never seen a woman jump off that chair as quick in my life.
Spiders are massive at the moment. It's ridiculous. We found a massive one, like, a week, 2 weeks ago, he was absolutely huge. I was standing up on top of the lid of the toilet, screaming for my wife.
That's an image. That's an image.
No, I was fully dressed, like, in fairness.
But, oh, God, unnecessary detail there.
He was I had my robe on. Yeah, he was inside in the bath, and he was they were absolutely massive. And I suppose this time of year, they're all coming into the house.
They're coming into the house. We'll find out.
We'll find out a little bit later on as to how to limit them. Not to keep them out, but how to limit them. You've been sending this in your text about chainsaws, funnily enough. Moira says...
Irish middle-aged men were looking up chainsaws and hatchets more now than we've ever done before.
And Moira says, my husband bought a pickaxe from the middle aisle at a convenience store about 10 years ago, still gathering dust in the shed.
Oh, yeah. Like, what are you going to be doing with a pickaxe?
A pickaxe?
Digging up the path.
A pickaxe?
A pickaxe.
What does a pickaxe look like?
You know the one with, like, a metally curve and then there's a handle in the middle?
Oh, like an ice pick?
Digging coal.
No, what people are saying is the hatchets for chopping wood.
Yeah.
Or big axes for chopping down trees.
Precisely. What are you going to do with the pickaxe?
Yeah, well, Rob says there's nothing manlier than chopping logs and nothing less manly than when it takes me about 10 swings to do it.
This is it. When you miss constantly or keep swinging at it and you shave off just a little sliver of the wood. Well, I did it.
Wamping into your shin, which is really not a good idea. Now, you were doing your quiz earlier, Tay-Tay or Shakespeare.
Yes.
And Darna, she says... Pretty proud I recognise that Romeo and Juliet line. Junior Cert English was my favourite. This was your competition. Who said it, Tay-Tay or Shakespeare?
You know, the lines are blurred as to, you know, the difference between the two, I have to admit. No,
she's a modern-day bard.
She is the modern-day bard.
Well, Linda says Shakespeare never wrote about Wicklow, so point to Taylor Swift.
Oh, there you go.
There you go.
There's still time to reach us on any or all of that. You can text us for free on the WhatsApps. The number is 089-611-111.
You can email irlandam@virginmedia.ie.
And you can find us at IrelandAM VMTV on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram.
Up next, it's the Queen of Country herself. Music legend Susan McCann is joining us after the break.
Welcome back. Now, our next guest is a country music legend who, for more than 50 years, has toured the world playing prestigious venues like Carnegie Hall, the famous Wembley country music shows, and Dollywood.
She's sung for two former US presidents and has even shared the stage with the great Dolly Parton. Now she's heading back on tour across the country. Susan McCann joins us. Good morning, Susan.
Good morning to you, Ray.
The First Lady of country music. Madam First Lady, thank you so much for joining us.
It's amazing the names that are given to us too, isn't it, really? Yeah.
Do you have security detail now? Like, once you're the First Lady, you're always the First Lady.
Well, at least they're all nice names they give you. They don't give me names that...
My husband, I never forgave him for it. He gave me that name.
Did
really?
Yeah.
And it stuck.
And he's outside there and I keep telling him.
Well, that's love.
You know, that's a good sign of respect, calling the First Lady.
My wife would call me something as nice as that.
Yeah.
I want to talk about the tour in a minute, but let's go right back. You were only a baby in Armagh. You were 16. When you started singing.
16, yeah. I started singing with a Cayley band called the John Murphy Cayley Band.
Yeah.
And, I was 16. I wasn't even allowed to go to dances at the time. My mum and dad wouldn't allow me to go out.
Well, I was going to say, you have a 17-year-old granddaughter now.
Yeah.
And even when you had your daughter... When she hit 16, would you have been sending her off to do gigs and the likes?
No,
not. Isn't that interesting?
No, not at 16. But then when I started off, it was different, really. The gigs were all different. And the man that owned the band, John Murphy, was a man in his 40s, and my dad knew him very well. So there were promises made on the night that I was allowed to join John Murphy's band.
Oh, right, okay.
That he collected me and he left me home. But having said that, I met my boyfriend in that band, so...
Your boyfriend and now husband.
Yeah.
How did the meeting come about?
Traveling in the van. How did it come about?
Falling in love. And still together all these years later. Tell us about when you got married, because I suppose at the time, in Armagh, in the 70s, it was a different world.
It was a different world. It really was. And thank God it's not the same now.
Yeah.
It was a very different world that time. I remember I was married on the 1st of September. And the internment was introduced on the August time. They were just burning the place down in the north. And I remember having my wedding dress in a shop in Newry. And Newry, so I don't know what happened. I think it was the day after it was announced, the internment thing was announced. And they were burning shops galore. And my wedding dress was sitting in the middle of Newry. I didn't take it home. So we had it. There were no buses going into Newry. So my brother John and his friends took me down in their car and onto the middle of the Dublin road. And we walked into Newry and collected me. And I walked through Newry in the big box of my wedding dress.
This is for fear that the shop was going to get burnt down.
Well, I was scared stiff. And yeah. I was getting married a few weeks later, you know. Yeah.
That's
but
mad.
I got it home anyway.
I was going to say you got the dress.
I did indeed. I did indeed.
And then then the career really took off, and you were saying,
I was married in 70, and I started in 1976.
Yeah.
To really, professionally,
Because you had said initially, I'm going to be a stay-at-home mum. I'm not going to be out on the road. Myself and Dennis are going to be there.
Yep.
And you even said initially, we're not going to travel farther than, 50 or 60 miles from...
And, well, that didn't last too long.
Yeah.
We didn't, but I suppose at the time we were, when you have two babies, Linda was only a year and a bit and Brenton was 2.5 or something. And, it was hard going, and we thought we can't leave them. The two of us are away, but sure, it ended all different. You know, Mummy and Daddy come in, and they, Lord have mercy in their souls, they looked after. And then I had a girl, Philomena. Philomena was great. She lived with me for 15 years, and she looked after them like a mummy. And they still treat her like a mummy.
Really?
Honestly, yeah.
You're still number one, though, I take it. You're still the first.
Well, she's the first lady.
Yeah. But
you've had some phenomenally interesting people that you've come across in your line of work. So you've played for two US presidents.
I did.
Which two?
For the Bushes.
Aren't you just
that's
a dote? That's George W.
That's just junior, and the 4 years or so before that.
Yeah.
I did the Strawberry Festival every year in Florida, and they would be out doing their, they didn't invite me to sing for them by any stretch of the imagination, but they were out doing their campaigning for the government for the presidency. And they come over and...
They came to you?
Oh, they were on the stage, they come up. I was doing my show at the time, they come into the park. So they were up on the stage and, me being me, I give them a tape and I said, well, you've nothing better to do, listen to that.
Stick that on. What is it like performing in Florida in particular, and I suppose...
Oh, it was great. It was unbelievable. The crowds that used to be there. It was like a... It wasn't all about singing. It was like a cultural thing, you know. And it was a bit like the Ploughing Championship, that sort of thing, where there was hundreds of thousands of people went every day to the, and they had all their produce, farming produce from the year, all there, and their animals and all sorts of stuff. And there were shows every night then.
Yeah,
and on the shows that had a. They had a marquee for me up built in I was billed as the Irish singer.
Oh.
Right.
They didn't even put my name on it.
I was going to say, what happened to the First Lady?
I know. I had to sing all Irish songs. It was great. We went down a bomb. It was brilliant. I did that for about 6 years.
You also met the very young Garth Brooks there, didn't you?
Before indeed.
She discovered him. That's what we're
before it was. I even heard of
look
in Ireland.
At you.
You photograph it. I look wearing well there, didn't I?
Oh, you don't. You look gorgeous.
Garth looks a bit pale in fairness.
Just a bit.
That was just before I was after finishing my show that he was there for it too, and he was in the dressing room right next to where we were. Uh-huh. So we came in and he was chatting away to us. Yeah. He was a lovely fella. He is a lovely fella now.
Did you go and see him when he played?
No, I didn't.
You've probably seen him too many times, have you?
Well, no, I didn't see him in Ireland because I was always working when he was here time. And this time my legs wouldn't carry me now to walk to Croke Park.
My daughter went, Linda went,
and she said, Mummy, you just wouldn't have made it.
Which it is a pity, for somebody, who has such a background in the industry, it wouldn't have been lovely to get to see him.
But I just love him singing anyways. He's great.
Tell us about these shows that you've got lined up.
I have them all lined up here.
She's not sitting on her laurels.
No, I'm not. Well, I haven't done concerts of my own since before lockdown.
Yeah.
And so I did, before lockdown, I did a series of String of Diamonds. I had a huge hit with the String of Diamonds album. Yeah. And so I call the tour the String of Diamonds tour. So just as lockdown happened, I had arranged, we had loads of dates arranged and we had to cancel them.
This is the thing, and everyone...
Oh, when you think back to that, it was unreal. But anyway, we're now... there's a young fellow, Brian Buckley. He's a young promoter, a great lad. He's a real hard worker, and he's put these dates together for me. So we're starting in Killarney on Thursday night, come the 27th, isn't it? Now, can I look at this?
You look at that, you look away.
And then we're in... And I'm doing a show in the Canal Court in Newry on Friday night, which is not on this. It's to raise money for our local church in Bessbrook. Yes. So that has to be done as well.
Yeah.
We're in St Michael's Theatre in New Ross.
On the 1st.
On the 1st, that's Tuesday, I think.
Wednesday.
Moat on the Wednesday, yeah.
November 2nd. Kilmore Hotel in Cavan on the 15th.
Yeah.
It's a great way to lead into the Christmas in the Town Hall Theatre in Westport on Sunday, November 20th.
Yeah.
Loughrea Hotel and Spa, Monday, November 21st.
I know.
And then the Enthus Theatre in Castleblaney.
It's not a queer
November
plug
22nd.
Now that I got for all those
that's
shows.
A great
Brian
plug.
Will just be delighted.
And when you've all that done, will you be settling down for a bit of a nice, relaxing time?
No, I won't. I have dates over the Christmas in the north as well, a few dates.
Do you ever sit still? Like, seriously?
Oh, well, I do. Like, I don't... Come the new year, now I'll be taking... And all over Christmas, I'm off, you know. So
we caught her being in her pyjamas the entire time.
I've been in them quite a bit.
Listen, thank you so much.
Oh, it was lovely being with you, and thank you for having me. It was lovely. Thanks,
pleasure to chat to you.
Sure, Susan. Pleasure. First Lady.
And a reminder that Susan's String of Diamond concert tour kicks off on the 27th of October. So for information and dates and occasions, head over to susanmccann.com.
You don't have to. We just gave you the whole list there. SusanMcCann.com. Up next, how to keep creepy crawlies out of your home this winter. We'll be back with you after this break.
Welcome back. In case you hadn't noticed, it's nearly winter, which means rain, wind, and a whole lot of spiders looking to take shelter in your house.
I'm not loving the itsy bitsy spider, can I just say? Fear not, though, because swinging into the rescue is Research Associate in Zoology at Trinity College and real-life Spider-Man, Collie Ennis, with some tips to keep the spiders out. But you kindly brought them in for us, didn't you?
I did. I brought
in really good of you.
A selection of what you'd commonly find around your house, the most common spiders that people will see.
Why? Why are we seeing so many of them at the moment? I know it's a silly question because of the weather, but what is there a reason behind it?
In many ways, they're very like us. They like comfort, so our houses are very warm and comfortable at this time of year. So that's really the reason they're inside.
Maybe a bit less warm and comfortable now with the energy crisis, so they might be a bit slower to come in this time around.
You've a big collection at home, and it's not just spiders. You've all different animals.
I particularly love amphibians and arachnids, which include the spiders. So I've a couple of hundred tarantulas.
And the family okay with that?
Well, it was a package deal, so
a couple of hundred tarantulas at home.
Yeah.
This is like the stuff of nightmares.
In a specific room, they're not like wandering around in front of the television or anything. So.
I'm not going to be sleeping tonight dreaming about these. Now, we're going to start with, is it the daddy long legs? Because we've all seen a few of these in the house. No, am I getting mixed up? Is it these?
Oh, you're right.
The cellar spider.
The cellar spider here. So it's a very dainty little spider.
Yes.
The ones you'll see in your bathroom, your hallway.
Always in the corners of the
room. Always in the corners, yeah. Like kind of damp areas, hence the common name, the cellar spider. A spider eating specialist, believe it or not, they like to eat other spiders. So if you have a lot of them around, you'll probably have less of the other spiders.
The rumour, and we can dispel whether this is true or not, that these are the most venom-filled spiders that would kill, but they just have no teeth or small teeth. Is this the truth or no truth?
Yeah, it's a myth.
It's a myth,
yeah. It came about because they were recorded, photographed, eating some of the red-belly spiders, the really...
Yes.
Venomous Lactrodectrus in Australia, and then the rumour kind of spread like that they were more venomous than them, which is just not the case.
We should leave those there and they'll get rid of some of the other spiders.
Yeah, and they're very, very kind of, they don't really get up to much. They kind of sit in their webs as opposed to wander around.
They taunt you. They're up in the corner and they're like, you can't reach us.
But listen, once they're paying rent, you don't mind. Is there a way to reduce, like, I know it's a silly question because you could just say close your windows, but is there a way to reduce the number of spiders you might get in the house or...
Yeah, well, you never get rid of them. You have to get rid of the idea of get rid of spiders because they're just everywhere, part, very valuable part of our food chain. So they are going to be around everywhere. Keeping a clean house, removing cobwebs, all that kind of stuff, less clutter, that gives them less spaces to hang around. That will reduce your numbers. Getting rid of them completely, it's
never going
really
to happen.
Now, this is the stuff of nightmares, the next one. The giant European house spider.
Yes.
And these actually have a Guinness World Record, which I think I'm horrified.
Look at that.
Look at the size.
He's literally posing for the camera, everybody.
Yeah, so these guys are the ones you find in your bathtub all the time because the males at this time of year are wandering around and they slip into the bath. Believe it or not, for spiders, they're very poor climbers.
Really?
So they kind of end up just getting stuck there. So if you don't want to find one of them in your bath, a great tip is just to leave a towel draped into the bath so they'll be able to wander back out. You know what I mean?
You mean wander into the bedroom? Like,
well, they're wandering around anyway, so it's probably best that you get them out of the bath in case you're going to hop in there, you know?
Can I ask you, what is this Guinness World Record that they have?
Allegedly, in the Guinness Book of Records, they're supposed to be the fastest species of spider in the world.
No.
I beg to differ with some of the species I've seen around the world. Some of the huntsmen in Australia, I call them teleporters because they just seem to be there 1 minute and across the room the next. Yeah, so I think it's probably one of the older recordings and maybe needs to be looked into.
But they are officially... What kind of speed are we talking there?
Well, very fast, very fast.
So how fast do we have to run to get away from them?
They'll be to the end of this table in a couple of seconds.
Oh,
really, really, really fast.
Now, moving on to the false widow, because these popped up a couple of years back and they were all over the news, they were all over everywhere that, you know, we didn't know whether they were dangerous or not dangerous or whatever. Talk us through the false widows, because you've got a male and a female here, haven't you?
Yeah, so that's the male there and the female's actually sitting on an egg sac there. Another way of keeping spiders' numbers low in your house, if you do see an egg sac around, is to remove it.
So I don't know if you can see, we might get an image of it, but the female's actually sitting on an egg sac with a load ready to go.
Stop!
And when that hatches out, hundreds of baby spiders would start to disperse and wander
and
off.
Tell me, they
Moon first... Can I be excused?
They first turned up in Bray.
Yes, so like... 20 years in the country, officially recorded 20 years ago, and have been really spreading quite successfully around the place.
Does it buy, what, a one-way ticket to get to Bray, or is it just hopping on bananas
it
from...
It could be multiple introductions through freight. It could have arrived in luggage. It's very hard to tell how they arrive, but they are here, and they're doing very well.
Do we need to be scared of these ones?
They can give you a nip, and they are officially a medically significant spider. Doesn't mean that they're out to attack you. They're not aggressive. If you were to get bitten by them, you will experience pain, somewhat similar to a bee or a wasp being. It's not the same thing,
really?
But it is a similar sensation.
So you will
sensation.
Experience some sort of pain if you do. And people can often get them confused between the false widow and the lace web spider.
Yeah, we have the lace web spider at the very end here. There's two species of lace web spider common around our windowsills in our house, and people tend to panic because they see them. They think they're false widows because they look very similar, a different life cycle, and one of our native species, and actually quite useful to have around the house because those lace webs that they build, they actually look like doilies around your windowsill. They'll stop woodlice, bluebottles, all that sort of stuff getting into your house. Spiders are fantastic to have around your house.
I need to clean the cobwebs inside the house, but at the windows and the doors, I need to leave them so that nothing's coming in.
Yeah.
Thanks, so you've made my life a little bit easier.
It's a bit of both. When it comes to the false widows, what should we do if you do find one? You know, because you're saying they bite, so how do we to manoeuvre them back outside? Or what's your advice there?
The best thing is the old cup with the piece of paper sliding under it and pop them outside.
Drive 200 kilometres down the road.
That's the best thing. But if you see one up in a web in the corner, they're not going to go near you. They're not going to be hassling you. The most important thing I say about spiders is don't panic about them. There's nothing in this country that's going to kill you or really harm you. We're very fortunate that way. And to be honest with you, they're doing you a great job of keeping the real nasty pests out of your house.
The problem is we've seen Spider-Man too often where Peter Parker is there and doing nothing innocently and the spider comes down and turns him into like radioactive man. So how does a false widow then, so if you do go at it, does it kind of go, rah, I don't like you, rawr?
No, it will bolt back into its web. It definitely won't go rawr. It will reverse. They're actually quite, you know, scaredy cats, really. They'll run away very...
I could start singing and I'd send all the spiders flying then.
The reason people get bit is because they're putting on a jacket and a spider's made a web in it.
Oh, stop!
And it will bite to defend itself. So that's the reason.
Yeah. Absolutely. No, I keep scaring her. Now, if you're really stuck, Collie, thank you so, so much.
You're very welcome.
If you're really stuck with a pest problem, I know some fellas who just love to exterminate. We're talking Daleks, the return of Doctor Who, and all the rest of next week's TV highlights after this short break. Welcome back. Now, Liz Truss isn't the only woman to step down from an iconic British role this week, but unlike the Prime Minister, we'll actually be sad to see the end of Jodie Whittaker's Doctor Who.
Joining us now is the TV expert who tells us that, like the TARDIS, her brain is bigger on the inside, it's Izzy Show Busy. You have a massive brain. And we're starting with Doctor Who, and it's a big event tonight.
Yeah, so it's the 100th anniversary special of Doctor Who, so the 100th episode. It's on BBC 7:30 tonight, and it's Jodie Whittaker's last episode. So she's the, I think she's the 17th Doctor Who.
Yes.
She's the first female, the 13th Doctor Who. She's been doing it since 2017. First female Doctor Who. It is going to be the end of her tonight, but it's going to be 90 minutes. It's a big special. I have heard that BBC have thrown the kitchen sink at this. So there's going to be lots going on.
Like, Doctor Who is iconic, do you know what I mean? And even if you're not even a Doctor Who fan, you kind of still get enthralled into the madness that surrounds it. And do we know who the 14th Doctor is?
No, you see, that's the big thing about this at the moment. So it hasn't been said who she's going to regenerate into.
Okay.
So there are rumours that it might be this guy called Shooty. Now, you know him from Sex Education.
Yeah.
So there was rumour that he was going in. He's going to be in the new Barbie movie as well. It hasn't been confirmed.
Okay.
And then there's another rumour that David Tennant, so 2008 Doctor Who, and everyone loved him, that he might be coming back with Catherine Tate and doing like a few specials, but it hasn't been confirmed, so just watch this space on
it. This is the thing, they want us all watching and keeping an eye on what's
This will be a weekly series then every Sunday for the next while, or is... Oh, this is the finale tonight.
Yeah, so this
Sorry.
Is the finale tonight. Yes. So I'm actually not sure if they're going to say who she's going to turn into in the episode. If that normally happens in Doctor Who, I suppose watch for that. But it's going to be a really good episode anyway. 90 minutes, as I said, it's the 100th anniversary special, so definitely worth a watch. Even if you don't watch Doctor Who, I feel like you could get into it tonight.
This is it, you see. Yeah, a lot of them are standalone. That's 7:30 tonight on BBC. Wendell and Wild is starting on Netflix this week.
Yeah, so that's on Netflix on Friday. So this is the Halloween movie for the family, right? So it's about these two brothers, Wendell and Wild, and they're like demons, and then they enlist the help of this teenager called Kat to summon the land of the living, right?
Oh.
But if you thought this was just for the kids, it's definitely not. It's by this fabulous director called Henry Selick. We can thank him for like James and the Giant Peach and stuff like that.
Yes.
And this did very well at the Toronto Film Festival as well. And Rotten Tomatoes.
It's also produced by Jordan Peele, who's Get Out, Us and Nope, which are massive. Like,
so this is spooky chills and thrills, but kid-friendly.
Kid-friendly.
Much like Coraline was as well, and The Nightmare Before Christmas.
And Rotten Tomatoes have given it 95%, which I just think is amazing. So, like, any movie that Rotten Tomatoes gives a high percentage, I'm like, I'm in.
Yeah.
And the thing is, if it's a kid's one, it's just about manageable horror-wise for me to manage. I can't, I'm not watching Hotel or any of that, or Motel or any of that. None of the scary stuff. That's good. So, that's for the kids, but then... Jeez, Netflix are doing loads of... Because there's the Midnight Club as well that we've been watching.
Yes.
Which, again, every October, Mike Flanagan brings out the horror series. Guillermo del Toro is getting in the action as well.
Yeah, so this is coming out on Netflix on Tuesday. So if you don't know who this guy is, he's like a Mexican horror filmmaker. We can thank him for Hellboy. So he's really into it. And he's doing, like, this eight-part series. So it's, like, an hour's movies. It's kind of like a series of movies. But what's interesting about this is up-and-coming, like, filmmaker is that he's kind of taken under his belt. So it's like six episodes will be the up-and-comers, and then he's directing to himself as well. So if you're into horror films, definitely worth a watch. I can't watch this. I will be behind the pillow. This is too much for me now.
No, this is me all over. So that's Cabinet of Curiosities, and it's starting on Netflix. See, this is my favourite time of year. Getting all the scares in now this whole week and into the next couple of weeks is absolutely up my aisle. The two of you can just watch your animation.
I like chillers, and I like a little bit of a... Do you remember the others, Nicole Kidman?
Yes.
A manageable, scary spookiness without too many big frights. I can't, or gore and blood, I can't be dealing. I've got enough of that to deal with when I'm at home with the family.
So listen, Izzy, moving on to probably one of the most talked about film you know, stories of the year. Harry Styles, his accent. This is Don't Worry Darling, which is coming to Virgin TV on demand on Monday. Very quick. That's what I was going to say. Very quick to move from film to thing. But that's the way the nature
of the beast. It's going. Yeah. So, like, this movie, like, I haven't seen it, but I need to watch it just because it's been surrounded. It is the most controversial movie of this year. If you're unfamiliar with the plot, though, it stars Florence Pugh as Alice and Harry Styles as Jack. And it's set in the 1950s. They're in this community. Life is apparently amazing, fantastic. And then all of a sudden things start to unravel and Alice is questioning things a lot. And there's a lot of twists and turns on this as well. I won't ruin too much. Like, I haven't watched it, but I have read a lot about it. Mixed reviews on this one, but because of the drama and the salad dressing and everything else.
Tell us about that. What happened there? What was going on behind the scenes?
There is so much going on behind the scenes on this one. So, like, first of all, Olivia Wilde and Harry Styles are going out. Uh-huh. But she was still married to Jason Sudeikis when she was filming, you know, the movie. And then there was all these rumours that they had an affair on set. Then the nanny came out that used to work for Olivia and Jason, saying that Jason knew about the affair and that he saw messages on Olivia's phone being like, I'm going to make Harry my special salad dressing. And that he had, like a heart attack, flew off the handle.
What does that mean?
What does that mean?
All right, okay.
We're not sure.
Is it literally making salad dressing?
She's actually putting up stuff on her Instagram, like a salad dressing recipe. Have you seen this?
No.
So she's actually made a bit of fun about it, saying that she was just having a bit of a laugh. What it means, I don't know. Yeah.
And even Florence Pugh kind of was, her and Olivia Wilde didn't get on. There was all the drama there as well. And then Harry Styles' accent, I know, was kind of taken into play a good bit on this one. Was this the one that was taken into play?
Yeah, so basically Shia LaBeouf was supposed to play Harry Styles' character, right? And so Olivia Wilde said in an interview, she was like, no, we had to fire him for, like, creative differences. And then Shia LaBeouf came with the receipts. He literally put out a video of Olivia Wilde, basically, where she's begging him to come back on set and saying, like, Florence Pugh, a.k.a. Miss Flo, like, needs to check herself. Mm. And so there was, like, loads of drama about that, loads of fighting going on back and forth. Olivia Wilde's not coming out looking great with everything that's going on at the moment. But this is her first movie anyway, and as I said, mixed reviews
Is there any chance, given what we've read about the reviews in general about the movie, is there any way that they'd make a series or a movie based on everything that happened around the making of this film?
Netflix need to do that.
That's a horror series.
Salad dressing.
the ten-part series.
We're going to Channel 4 next for season 5.
Another scary one, yeah.
Of The Handmaid's Tale. Now, it's icky.
To care about her, we opted out on the basis that, like, we can't be so stressed anymore watching this.
Yeah, there is those shows where you kind of just need to take a breath or watch, like, an episode of The Kardashians.
But it's fantastic.
In between,
Elizabeth Moss is amazing, and she's an incredible actor, and it's on Channel 4.
Channel 4 tonight at 9 p.m. And just to say, not to ruin anything, but at the end of season 4, you know, there's a big character development for her, and there was that pivotal moment at the end of season 4, so I'm interested to see how they're going to start season 5 now, and there's 10 episodes in this.
Excellent. And a quick look for the Trekkies. Love a bit of Star Trek. Mm-hmm. Now, this is not as stressful. This is Star Trek Prodigy. The second series on Paramount Plus is on this Thursday.
Yeah, so this is geared more towards the kiddies. I think it's the first Star Trek that is geared towards the kids.
Oh, it's an animation.
It is. It's an animation, and it's basically just about, like, this motley crew of aliens that are on different voyages on their Star Trek ship.
Yeah.
You're a Trekkie for one, you're a Trekkie for all. So, like, we're saying it's for the kids, but I guarantee you the adults, and especially the Trekkies...
Oh, there's Janeway.
Yeah, we'll be glued to this. And that's Paramount Plus this Thursday. Yeah?
Yes.
Brilliant. Izzy, show busy.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Much obliged. Right, earlier we baked up some festive Barmbrack. If you fancy some, here's how we did it.
Mix together the flour, salt and sugar in a bowl with orange zest and cinnamon. Crumble the yeast, pour the milk and egg into the flour, mix the dough. Add the diced butter and dried fruit to the dough. Cut into 3 equal portions and shape into loaves. Bake the loaves at 200 degrees Celsius for 25 minutes until rich golden in colour. For the whiskey glaze, dissolve 30 grams of sugar in a saucepan with water. Once the loaves are baked, brush with the whiskey glaze and you're ready to go.
Over there.
Now I have that Barmbrack locked away.
I'll hold him down and you run and get it right.
I'll throw spiders on you, don't start me.
We're having Barmbrack and spiders for our tea.
Have we got time for a few texts or what? What's the crack?
Spiders. Sean says, moved into a new place recently and on the first night my girlfriend found a spider in the bathroom. She asked, is it too late to move again?
Mm. Oh, God. Kira says, lived in Australia for 12 years and a lot of spiders are huge but mostly harmless. I got bitten one by the leg. So you met one of the bad ones, yes. Okay, great.
And Niamh, I always felt sorry for the spiders. I don't know why people find them so scary. Most of them are friendly. Have you seen the spider picker upper grabber thing? Have you gotten those ads
brushy
on Instagram?
No?
Yeah, it's like a brushy thing that
and
you
it picks them up.
It's got a long handle and it does a kind of a
yeah.
It's like that's the international sign language for picking
up a spider. Anne has a tip. She says, I put mint plants in my windows. Spiders hate mint.
And really? Sure, if you're having an El Mojito, isn't it handy out?
There you go.
Sort of, I guess. This one is horrifying. Jody says, got bitten by a white-tailed spider in Australia years ago. My leg was pretty much black and blue, but I barely felt it because I was delirious.
There you go.
Irish spiders aren't so bad. Do you ever do that thing where you come back from holidays and you unpack your case and something crawls out of it? That happened to me one time.
I burned the house down.
Lads, I'm not going to sleep tonight at all, so
just
I'm
don't
not.
Travel.
This is horrifying.
Do what I don't
live in
travel.
A bubble. Live in a bubble.
Yeah, another reason to not go to Australia. Right, coming up tomorrow, the guys get into the spirit of the spooky season with some creepy crafts.
We meet the 22-year-old whose organs had started to fuse together by the time she was diagnosed with endometriosis.
All that plus food, fashion and the news you're waking up to. Ireland AM is live from 7 on Virgin Media 1. Have a really, really good day.
Enjoy the rest of your weekend. Bye-bye.